Gaye was one of the most talented people I've ever known. One of the most musically creative minds ever. But he was a very troubled man on the inside.
When will it end? When will people start getting together again? And one of the things that makes him such an incredibly attractive artist is that he takes that which is raw and painful and transforms it into something absolutely gorgeous. Besides what I bring. His penchant for misery was creative.
Marvin Gaye understood how to reach the human being. He takes the mundane and breathes the transcendent into it. Let's get it. If you're a person who's outraged by war, Marvin's music is for you. If you want to make love, Marvin's music is for you. If you want to talk about the conditions of spirituality when it's infused in the secular world, Marvin's music is for you. Please, please, baby, let's get it on. Oh! There's no question that the music he left behind is a catalog of the full range of human emotion.
Someone says, Marvin Gaye, you're a legend. How do you react?
Oh, baby, honey, please.
I think a legend as what it is. It's a story, and I'm quite sure I have a story. How important it is, or how terrific it is, or anything like that, I'm not so sure about, but it's exciting. It's full of drama and life.
Listen. Baby.
The family in which Marvin Gaye was born in 1939 in Washington, D.C., was one fraught with conflict and confusion. Much of it stemmed from the rage of a father who hid his own contradictions behind the cloth of his ministry.
My father was a traveling minister, and we were of a very small denominational body, and I don't imagine today there's more than, 1,000 of us.
In those years, my father was a very strict disciplinarian. I think one of the problems that my father had with my brother was that he didn't realize that Marvin was a free spirit. He didn't like to be told what to do.
He would always tell Marvin that, you know, he didn't know where he came from. I don't know where you came from, boy. You're not mine. You know, there's too much of the devil in you.
His father was a strange man by any measure. He was a man who wore female clothing. He's a man that Marvin was ashamed of.
Marvin, seeing his dad, who on one hand was this charismatic preacher and on the other hand was a cross-dresser, was a source of great confusion for him. And when Marvin looked for paternal love in his childhood, what he received was not only scorn, but intolerance and violence.
My father was a man of spare the rod, spoil the child. And he'd never spare it the rod.
Marvin didn't obey, he would whip him, you know, he'd hurt him. with a belt. And often Marvin told me he would make him get undressed and he would sort of beat him up when he was naked. So he ran to his mother for protection and solace. She was loving and understanding. Marvin was inordinately attached to his mom and remained that way his entire life.
Marvin loved his mother so much because she was there to defend him and to encourage him in just about everything. She told him he would be a great star one day.
Out of this familial discord would emerge an extraordinary passion for music. Days spent singing in his father's choir left Marvin with a thirst for the approval he was denied at home.
I've always wanted to sing, but that's where I got my opportunity to sing when I was a child.
The church thing turned into a high school thing. That's when he put his little groups together. Doo-woppers, that's exactly the way it was.
We'd go down the corner, and everybody would doo-wop and snap their fingers under the light and try and get a bass voice, because everybody was talking in high soprano then, you know. We were trying to get in the deep voice, and, you know, we'd do all sorts of things. Marvin sang that all the time, the music that we loved. He sang it all the time, but he never sang it around that house.
The problem was that Marvin's dad was convinced that that was a terrible mistake, that Marvin was leaving God, Marvin was leaving the church, Marvin was leaving his calling. And I think Marvin's father's voice telling him no, 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 really haunted Marvin. He carried the extremes of his childhood church, the sort of fundamentalist Pentecostal attitude of all or nothing, of total ecstasy or doom throughout his entire life.
I think we have two sets of gods in us. I think we have to decide which power we are going to serve. It's simple as that.
Torn between his sacred obligations and his secular aspirations, Marvin escaped, dropping out of high school and joining the Air Force at 17.
I did a horrible stint in the Air Force. It was terrible. I got an honorable discharge under general conditions in Section 214. Something about unable to adjust to regimentation and authority and good riddance or something, I don't know. You are
my pride. After his discharge, Marvin sang with several groups before making the move to Detroit and a little-known startup company called Motown Records. You've got kisses sweeter than honey.
Marvin Gaye had been brought to Motown by Harvey Fuqua. He had been a moon glow, and he also sang in a spiritual group. We didn't know he was a singer because he went around all the time with this straw hat on his head, this pipe in his mouth, and these sunglasses, so you couldn't really see how fine he really was.
I'm pretty sure that we all said, oh my God, he's so cute. He had this very boyish kind of air about him. I believe every woman who ever saw Marvin Gaye had a crush on Marvin Gaye.
You must understand, at that time, I was totally obscure as an artist, and I hadn't even had a single record or anything. I was just a musician, a studio musician, a session drummer and songwriter, and trying to hustle my way around at Motown.
Marvin was surrounded by a remarkable array of talent. The Miracles, Martha and the Vandellas, and the Temptations.
In terms of black popular music, black people had not had an institution like Motown. When it got around that this was becoming a mecca, people started going up that way.
Most of the people that came to Berry Gordy at that time had absolutely no clue of what we were to do and how we were to achieve it. We were expecting Berry Gordy to make us a star. He was just not building a group of artists, he was building a name.
29-year-old Berry Gordy was Motown's founder and driving force. A former boxer and factory worker, Berry Gordy had a grand ambition to make Motown the General Motors of the recording industry.
Oh yes, Motown was much like the factory that Berry Gordy had worked in. and with the assembly line.
Take the song from the writer, give it to the producer. Producer give it to the artist. Producer then turn it over to the engineers. You didn't even get to mix your own music then.
Everybody had a job or designated whatever your expertise was in, and that's what you did.
Many people think that the Motown family is mythical. They think that it cannot possibly have been that everybody there had a family-type relationship, but that's exactly how it was.
We all dated each other, you know what I mean? It was that kind of thing. This was our neighborhood, and we just went in there, and it was everybody wanted to come there.
Berry Gordy's sister, Anna, worked at the company. She was 36. Marvin was just 21. Before long, they were an item.
She was older, but you know how young men like older women and older women like younger men. And I don't think they were thinking about age. It was just an attraction.
No, Anna was a good-looking woman. Anna held her own. Anna was looking good. Anna was a good-looking woman. That was a fine woman. I would have married her. I'm 17 years old. I would have married her.
I believe one of the reasons that Marvin was attracted to her was because I think she reminded him of his mother. Then I'm sure that the fact that she was the sister of the president of the record company didn't hurt any either.
With his marriage to Anna, Marvin was entitled to a seat at the Motown family table. But always rebellious, he yearned to carve out his own musical identity. He wanted to be part of Motown. He just didn't want to sing Motown.
I was a bit spoiled. I was a prima donna. I was the president's brother-in-law, and I was rather ridiculous about things that the other acts were doing. I don't know. I seemed to sort of enjoy being able to say, I don't have to do that. You guys do that, you know. I don't have to do that.
Quiet nights and quiet stars, quiet chords from my guitar, floating on the silence that surrounds us.
If you think about how he begins at Motown, here he is at a company that has discovered it has sort of teenage hits, kind of a new fangled rhythm and blues, and he doesn't want to do it. He wants to sit on a stool and smoke a cigarette and be cool. He wants to be Frank Sinatra.
Ambitious as he was, Marvin's dream was to reach a wider audience, white as well as black.
He says, no, I'm not going to give you rhythm and blues. And he's able to cut an album of standards, of a kind of a jazzy Frank Sinatra style. But it doesn't work.
Marvin couldn't pull that off because the people weren't buying that on the records during that time.
And then he suddenly is looking around and he's seeing Mary Wells has a hit and Smokey Robinson and the Miracles have a hit. Because he's a competitive person, he wants to hit. He writes and sings a song called Stubborn Kind of Fella. So even when he capitulates, he does it with a kind of a defiant honesty that will be his hallmark throughout his career.
Marvin was a genius, but he was a very competitive person. Marvin wanted to get there first. He wanted to be acknowledged as the only one, and he wanted to be seen as the superior one. When he's on stage with, you know, Stevie Wonder, and Stevie Wonder goes out and really basically kicks his butt, you know. I mean, who's going to compete against Stevie Wonder? He's blind, he's a kid, and he's a genius. That's a hell of a combination. And Marvin was not nice in the way he framed it. Don't let that little blind sucker go on before me anymore.
He wanted to do things his way, first of all, what he thought was the right road to take for his career. And a lot of times, Barry and him would disagree on things like that, and they would argue profusely.
I couldn't deal with many of the political problems that I had to encounter at Motown, and many times it sort of spilled over into personal disagreements and in some cases some violent, semi-violent disagreements between Barry and myself.
Despite his conflicts with the company, Marvin turned out a string of hits. In less than 2 years, his dreams were realized. He was a star and a sex symbol.
Marvin was the most versatile, probably R&B singer, soul singer of the era, maybe of all time, because Marvin could sing a mellow, he could sing raw, he could sing soft, he could sing a little falsetto.
He was a person who could sing any kind of music you put in front of him. And I mean, really sing it. He would Marvinize it. And he would do some stuff that, you know, I wanted to keep everything he did on every take and just put it all on the record, but you couldn't do that, you know.
Marvin was a true recording artist in that he was happy in the studio because he could control his environment. He was uncomfortable as a performer. He had performance anxiety.
When we went on the Motown Review tours, we had to stand backstage and help him to learn how to do the hitchhike, because he couldn't really dance. Oh, he looked very awkward.
Couldn't dance a lick. Couldn't dance a lick. He pat his foot like a white boy. I used to say, Marvin.
As I think about Marvin, I say, here's someone that was so brilliant, but so unsure. We just stand there and just watch him on the side of the stage. And he was just, and even in his not knowing how to dance, he was so beautiful. And how can you not know how beautiful you are?
I'd be doggone if you ain't a pretty thing, baby. And I'd be doggone if you ain't warm as a breath of spring. Oh, baby.
Marvin was the Prince of Motown. But it was an uneasy crown he wore. He was filled with doubt about his fame, even as Motown decided to exploit his sex appeal with a series of romantic duets. Marvin reluctantly first recorded with Mary Wells, then Kim Weston. Then, in December of 1966, he found the perfect partner in newcomer Tammy Terrell.
To me, it was just him and Tammy. When she started recording with Marvin, she called me up. She said, guess what? I said, what? She said, girl, I'm going to do a duet with Marvin Gaye. I said, what? She said, yeah, you think I can? I said, no, don't start that, Tammy. I said, you're going to be great.
The physical attraction between their two voices was just gravitating, because she was very sassy and he had that growl that, you know, people love to hear from him. And I think that's what made it really work, because it just zooed, you know, sexuality.
Ain't nothing like the real thing, baby. Ain't nothing like the
how Tammy would look at him. She looked at him with such, you would never believe they weren't lovers. I just remember them being great performers together.
I think he really liked Tammy Terrell. When I say like not romantically, he really liked her as a person. And they had a real melding. They had a real, and he became like a kind of a brother to her.
Ain't No Mountain High Enough and the recordings that followed established Tammy and Marvin as the most popular recording duo of their time. Then tragedy struck. During a concert in October of 1967, Tammy collapsed on stage into Marvin's arms. She was diagnosed with a brain tumor. It was a loss that would traumatize Marvin for the rest of his life.
It took him a while to realize what was happening, even when we were recording the last days. I think he was so protective of her and always trying to make her comfortable.
Things bothered Marvin spiritually, and he always felt like somehow or other he had something to do with Tammy's sickness or something like that, when he didn't.
He was thrust into the depths of a profound depression. He basically didn't speak on stage. He didn't perform. He didn't come out of his shell.
An artist, if he's really an artist, he has these fits of depression because he feels, he's like a sponge. He picks up and you retain it. And the only way you can get these feelings off is to put it in your music. Don't you know?
On one hand, you have the image of Marvin as this wonderful romantic figure. But in reality, Marvin was going through all kinds of hell, and he had a very complicated relationship to women, particularly to Anna, his wife.
Marvin and Anna had adopted a son, Marvin III. But his success as a sex symbol injected jealousy and suspicion into their already strained marriage. Despite his troubles at home, his career prospered. His recording of Norman Whitfield's I Heard It Through the Grapevine became the best-selling single in Motown history. That much to me. You should have told me yourself
that you love someone else. Marvin Gaye's version was sheer paranoia. It was full of fear, and Marvin seemed to pour all of his personal existential problems and drama into this song, which made it so compelling.
Throughout his life, this notion of romantic agony was a key component. And, you know, Marvin even went as far as going to motels where he was convinced Anna was having an affair. So he needed this kind of drama to excite his creative imagination.
Airstrikes with napalm and high explosives. It burns off the protective cover for the entrances, and in some cases of caved-in hidden bunkers and tunnels.
I think it was around 1969 and 1970, about that period at Motown Records, when I stopped thinking so much about my erotic fantasies, and I started to think about the war in Vietnam. My brother told me some pretty horrible stories about the war. At the same time, there was a great deal of unrest in America. The Martin Luther King crusades and the shootings of the kids on the college campuses, and I don't know, I sort of saw the country headed for modern day civil war. Something happened with me during that period. I felt a strong urge to write music and to write lyrics that would touch the souls of men.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find.
Marvin had gotten social, and Marvin had gotten to sing pain or to sing his innermost feelings in his music. And that was the change that I saw. And it was a different Marvin.
when he first started to work on What's Going On, I would go around to his house, and he'd be in there at the piano, and he'd be saying, you know, Smoke, God is writing this, man. He'd say, I'm not writing this. God is writing this. And when you listen to it, I believe him.
The irony is that he knew where he was and who he was so long before the company even would allow him to be. It was so new, they couldn't hear it. They couldn't understand it.
When Marvin Gaye wanted to do a protest album, I was petrified. I was very scared that he was going to ruin his image.
And Marvin bet his life that What's Going On with him. And they finally released it. It was a smash.
When I heard Marvin sing it, I was like, yes, yes, yes. Because he was extremely soulful. He nailed life at that time. You know, the movement, not just the black struggle, but, you know, the universal struggle. He nailed it.
Marvin Gaye just helped facilitate the transformation of soul music in a very powerful way with What's Going On. Because, first of all, it's a theme album. Black music was being dismissed as unintellectual. And Marvin Gaye showed that you could have powerful jazz-like melodies and beautiful harmonies, and at the same time, make an extraordinarily moving and poignant record.
Obviously, I learned a great deal because the album was What's Going On, probably the greatest piece of work that Motown has ever put out.
After the success of the What's Going On album, I didn't have a great deal of trouble with my creative freedom. I think it did more to help me become an independent type.
In 1972, the mayor of Washington, D.C. proclaimed May 1st Marvin Gaye Day. At the Kennedy Center that evening, his father saw him perform for the first time. Marvin would later say it was the only time he ever felt that he made his father proud.
No matter what stage of Marvin's life, he was continually haunted by his dad's voice, telling him, where's your church? Why are you singing the wrong kind of music?
Marvin brought home an attaché case with $1 million in it. And when he threw it on the bed and said, what do you think now, Father? He says, I still say, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul?
Marvin was wary of his father and yet depended upon him and loved him. Marvin sought his father's approval, and the more his father withheld it, the harder Marvin tried.
Marvin's relationship to his dad and his dad's penchant for cross-dressing had a huge impact on him. And as he got older and older, he feared that this tendency was in him. He overcompensated. So you have, for years and years, Marvin trying to, you know, prove to the world, you know, how macho he was.
His overwhelming need to prove himself even extended to sports.
It had to do with one thing. He couldn't do it when he was a child. His dad would not let him do those things. Anything like that was devil's work.
In the dead of winter, when there was snow on the ground, Marvin would come and knock on my door at 7 o'clock in the morning. Smoke, come on, man, go run with me. Because nobody else was crazy enough to do this. I was. Come on, let's go run, man. Let's go run to the mile. Because he was training to be on the Detroit Lions football team at that time. That was his aspiration.
Marvin's struggle to hold on to any remnants of his religious upbringing was further challenged when he moved to Los Angeles in late 1972. While in an L.A. studio working on his new album, he met 16-year-old Janice Hunter.
I remember the first time he drove me home, the first time he kissed me, and we were standing at the bottom of my stairs, and he took my face in his hands, And I thought he was going to kiss me on the lips, and he kissed me on my forehead, and it was one of the sweetest kisses I've ever had. And that was really the beginning of our relationship.
And he met her, and Marvin fell in love. Unless Marvin fell in lust. Marvin fell in love lust.
This very young teenage girl, she became a muse to him. Then the shift from What's Going On to Let's Get It On was about this tension between the spirit and the flesh. And Marvin Gaye is constantly torn between his due diligence when it came to his Pentecostal background, and for a while he staved off the big demon of sexual obsession nearly, and yet eventually he gave into it.
Let's Get It On, it was straight up sexual. It was about sexual freedom. It was about his sexual freedom. It was about what he felt about men and women and being physical. And he was not afraid to express any of it. I'm asking you, baby, to get it on with me.
He understood sex on a certain level, and understood how to use his voice to create a sexual environment. Like, I think it's, I don't know if anybody's as sexy as Marvin Gaye.
After two successful albums, Marvin flexed his new clout within the company. He renegotiated his contract with Motown, demanding and getting his own studio and production company.
Loved that studio. That was his pride and joy.
The way he would overdub his own voice, and the way he would make lyrics up as he go, and the way he would take instruments. I mean, it could be a fart, and he would hit it on something to give a sound.
He was a genius in front of that dead microphone. Because he could do some things that people wouldn't realize. You know, Marvin's doing all the voices.
Background and a lead, and to color the background is four to five different harmony parts. And that's what you hear.
I think the irony about Marvin is that the different voices in his head, one whispering, love God, another whispering, get everything you can, these warring voices which tore him up, he was able to harmonize, literally harmonize in his art.
Precious, pure, and fair.
Ooh. With Janice, Marvin also discovered a new personal happiness. Though he was still married to Anna, he and Jan moved in together. They soon had a daughter, Nona, and a son, Frankie.
He did have family values. As distorted as they may have been, and as dysfunctional as his own family was as he was growing up, he did his best to create his own family, to have his children around him, to have a home. And for us, it wasn't an easy thing to do because we were both heavily addicted to drugs and alcohol.
There's a lot of drugs in LA. You have hallucinogens, marijuana, coke. There's all kinds of pills going on out there. And Marvin was definitely a victim of that.
Marvin was pretty much a lifelong pot smoker, and it's not till the mid to late 70s that he gets deeper and deeper into cocaine.
Once you get into the cocaine pretty heavy, you'll go through money fast without even realizing it. We had gone on tour, 77.
And next thing I know, I read in the papers that the Internal Revenue had come and confiscated everything at Marvin's house.
Marvin's extravagant lifestyle, his failed investments, and his expensive drug habit hastened his downward spiral. When Anna finally filed for divorce, he couldn't pay the alimony. His lawyer proposed an alternate solution.
This is Anna's song.
Marvin's lawyer, Curtis Shaw, suggested in order to give Anna something, she would get the proceeds of his next album.
So he did an album called Hear My Dear that sold about six. I laughed. That was the funniest album I'd ever heard in my life. I said, Marvin, what did you do on this album? He said, I just did what the judge told me to do, Bobby Taylor.
And Hear My Dear is kind of, in a way, the dark side of, you know, Let's Get It On. Let's Get It On is all sex is good, sex is fun, you're hot. And that album, apparently, you know, everyone says was written about Jan. Hear My Dear, sex is not fun. Sex is dangerous and dark and leads you to bad places.
As he began this work, his initial attitude, I'm going to do something bad so she doesn't make any money, was trumped by, again, his artistic integrity. And he went for the truth.
People just was not ready for that type of earnestness. Like, you know, I don't understand if you love me, why would you turn me into the police? You feel like you were eavesdropping on a conversation or maybe just some of his private mutterings to himself, you know.
And in Anna's song, again, he gives a kind of a mini history of their relationship.
It just kind of like escalates. Anna, Anna. Anna, it's just so, it's opera.
Anna, 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 yeah.
And if you want to really get to know Marvin Gaye in the most personal way, you have to listen to Hear My Dear.
In October of 1977, after his divorce from Anna, Marvin finally married Jan. But it was too late. Their marriage was overwhelmed by drugs, debt, and infidelities. It lasted only 2 years.
One of the great contradictions about Marvin that he was never able to resolve was that he wanted simple domestic happiness. But at the very same time, he did all he could to undermine that happiness. His life was full of betrayal, most of which was his own creation. At the end of the 70s, marriage number two had fallen apart. He's at odds with Motown, doesn't want to record for him anymore. He owes the IRS millions. He's out of money entirely. He goes to Hawaii where he lives in a bread van.
For the time that we were separated, I think he was happy to have the distance between us. The studio was gone. He and I were not on very good terms. And I think that for him, going to Hawaii was like a brave new world, like a getaway for him.
I visited with him while he was there. And he was just going through a bunch of trouble at that time. He kind of like divorced himself from everyone. He was really searching for something, himself, really. Marvin was loved by many people. And I think that he knew that he needed to be loved by Marvin. That was the problem.
Spiraling out of control, Marvin was a 41-year-old falling star. He sought refuge in England, where he was again engulfed by drugs, sex, and another deep depression. Desperate for spiritual redemption, Marvin found a savior in a fight promoter named Freddie Cozart.
Belgium was, in many ways, a last-ditch effort to try to save Marvin Gaye from himself.
It's in Ostend where the air is clear and he's far away from the sort of decadent scene of London or Paris or L.A. or New York, where he's able to regain a semblance of sanity.
He had gone to Belgium and gotten his life back together. He was running again and keeping himself in shape and doing all those things. Just let your love
come shining through. He was going to get in the ring again. He was going to fight his way up the charts.
My goal at this point is to just be a better artist. You see, I've gone through 3 years of pretty rough time and sort of forgot my true nature. Real funky on them chords,
real funky. Many times I look back on that and I wish that he had just stayed in Belgium.
I was doing a tour and I called Marvin saying, oh, I called him from the airport and said, I'm in town. He said, oh, baby, come on over. And then he said, I got something I want you to hear. And I said, okay. And he put on Sexual Healing. And he says, what you think, baby? I'm like, Marvin, that is brilliant. He says, are you sure you think they're gonna like it? I'm like, they're gonna love it. And he was so unsure of that.
After a three-year absence, Marvin returned to the States in triumph. With the breakout hit Sexual Healing for CBS Records, Marvin seemed to have found a balance between his devout and secular desires.
When I listened, I said, okay, yeah, Marvin, you saying it right to the point, almost without saying the show enough words, you know. But I said, well, women are going to love this. And true enough, you know, when he would break off into it, when you could hear the women start squealing and howling and throwing their arms up and doing all that, I said, yeah, that's a girl song.
Let's make love tonight. That unmistakable, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, because you do it right. I mean, it was like, wow. You know, you just can, you can never forget that. I mean, it was very, very simple, but very poignant. I remember hearing that on the radio and saying, man, Marvin is back. Marvin Gaye came back strong. Because Sexual Healing, we knew, was just a monster hit.
This year's Grammy Award goes to... The Only Thing That I Like, Sexual Healing by Marvin Gaye.
Thank you very kindly, ladies and gentlemen. I am not very much for speeches. I'm not much of a public speaker, I always say that. I've waited a very long time, 20-some years, to win an award such as this. Thank you, ladies.
Marvin came back to the States from Belgium because his mom was sick, and then he went on tour.
I saw him perform at the Circle Star Theater. It was one of the most amazing shows I've ever seen. I mean, it was just unbelievable. And his voice was back, and he sounded amazing. I went to this hotel room. Wild Willow Sports is on in this corner. Wild Willow Sports. There's two guys who I assume are kind of bodyguard guys here. And here's Marvin. I kept asking, why wasn't he doing more? You know, what's going on? He talked a lot about the fact that that moment had passed for him and that he was really interested in his own contradictions. He was very, very articulate about his own psychosis.
The last tour, all the hangers-on was them and was spending all the money that the man was making. And because he is so afraid out there by himself, he let it happen.
His last tour, the Sexual Healing tour, he has a preacher in one room and a cocaine dealer in the next room, and his divided soul becomes more and more kind of literal.
God in one room, the devil in the next. The climax of the show is he comes out singing Sexual Healing. Takes off the robe and there he is in his underwear. Marvin, in his altered consciousness, was convinced he had to give his public more and more his raw sexuality. So you have him making something of a spectacle of himself.
Cut to 3 or 4 months later, Radio City Music Hall. His voice is shot. He can't hit any notes. And he's unsteady on stage. It's one of the worst shows ever seen by anybody that good.
The last time we saw him at, I think it was Radio City. I think the people around him was just, I don't know. But we lost him at that point.
In August of 1983, Marvin gave his final performance in Los Angeles. Addicted and exhausted, he retreated to the home he had bought for his parents.
When he came home, he wanted peace. And everybody was pulling at him, left and right.
When Marvin returned, the hangers-on returned too. Though people close to him tried to shoo these people away, Marvin eventually sought them out, or at least accepted their overtures.
And they would come night and day. And I think that's what upset Father, was the traffic. They had no respect for Marvin's father or his mother. They would come at 2 o'clock in the morning. The girls would be in the garden screaming, "Marvin, let me in." There was a lot of tension in the house, and it was building within Father, because he seemed to be fighting with Mother more. And then Marvin was building up too, because he was getting sicker and sicker.
He's addicted out of his mind. The drugs are making him absolutely kooky. He's paranoid. He believes everybody's out to get him.
Just things that came out of his mouth that you knew were not Marvin. It was like the devil almost inside of him.
One of the great ironies of Marvin's life is that he created his own story. He manipulated the elements to end in a way that seemed to him to be inevitable.
The day before his 45th birthday, Marvin Gaye, whose entire life had been marked by conflict, willfully violated a sacred covenant that would finally free him from his demons.
And it all began because Marvin's dad was yelling at his mother earlier in the day, and Marvin said, "I don't like the way you're talking to my mother," and so on and so forth. You have the escalation, and then Marvin finally just beat his father up, which of course he'd been wanting to do that his whole life.
Pops, and he was in his father's room, and Father kept the gun that Marvin bought for him.
Bishop Gaye stood in that doorway and pointed that gun while Marvin was staring at him. Mother Gaye said he shot him one time, and he started to slump. And as he slumped down on the floor, Mother Gaye said he shot him the second time.
Soul singer Marvin Gaye has been shot dead at his father's home in Los Angeles. From Los Angeles, Steve Futterman.
According to the police report, the father took out a handgun and shot Marvin Gaye 3 times. He was pronounced dead on arrival at a hospital.
I was driving home, listening to the radio, and the disc jockey interrupted the program to say, "Soul singer," I know, I hear it in my mind, like it happened today. Soul singer Marvin Gaye was pronounced dead on arrival at the hospital. So now I don't buy this. My heart, my innards won't let me accept this. So I get out of my car, there's a phone booth right there, and I go to the phone and I call Anna. And I say, "Anna, this is Smoke." She said, "Yeah, baby." I didn't even have to ask her. She said, "Yeah, baby, it's true. His dad shot him." What? What?
Oh, yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away.
Marvin died long before he was shot. By that I mean he was spiritually drained. He was just so tired.
I brought you in this world and I'll take you out of here is a saying that we were brought up with, where the average parent in our community never allowed a child to stand up to them. Marvin knew that if he put his hands on his father was going to retaliate.
Marvin wanted to go. Marvin didn't want to be here anymore.
Have to go. I don't know. Tell you, I don't know. The little girl wouldn't say.
I think he was driven by his demons and by his angels. He was driven by some need to reconcile the two, and he never could.
Marvin's body was a billboard for his spiritual struggle. And the war was waged on the battlefield of his mind and his spirit, which is the very quality that made his music great, but the very vulnerability that made his life hell.
Now I need a place to hide away. Lord,
I always felt that Marvin was an angel. He came, he did what he needed to do, and he left us a great musical legacy.
To learn more about Marvin Gaye, visit PBS.org.
Save that sweet world.